talking literally blow your mind. I'm trying to blow your mind. I'm talking literally blow your mind.
Here we go, fight fans. We're back with yet another installment of the 2-Minute Warning Pride Rules MMA podcast. Bringing the knowledge as usual, we got Omar. What's up, Omar?
Hey, Carl. How you doing? I'm ready to get this thing started. It's backcountry. I'm the Hunter S. Thompson of this fair ship, so let's get going.
I love it. Tommy, what's good?
What's going on, everybody? Happy holidays, Merry Christmas, Happy Hanukkah or Kwanzaa, whatever the hell it is you celebrate. And let's get to talking about bashing Conor this week. Let's go.
And bringing up the caboose as usual. What's up, Chris? What's up?
Where's Jose Waldo? Has anybody seen No Jose Waldo?
Oh,
and
he's
as
coming
usual,
up to 155.
Yeah. He runs rampant.
I, of course, am the glue that holds this show together. Carl Glucci, what's up? All I want to say is the UFC better chill with all this interim belt shit. In the words of the great Conor McGregor, they're fooling absolutely nobody. So with that being said, we're going to jump right into it here, guys. We kind of had a little bit of a discussion last night, late minute, regarding the women of the UFC. I just wanted to get a quick take on everybody's favorite female fighter in MMA looks-wise. We're not going with talent. I'm going to see who you guys think
man,
is the most attractive.
This is really like we're going this route with the whole female thing?
We're starting it out.
Wow. Damn,
no talent whatsoever.
Demographic.
The only reason I'm bringing it up
what
is
demographic?
Because,
yo, I'm working on it, man. I got a female next week that she's going to probably be a guest.
Well,
like
honestly,
is she related to you?
No,
she is not.
Not yet.
Okay. Oh.
Wait. Hopefully, she's not listening. Jesus.
Yeah. Well, the only reason I brought that up is because of the UFC on Fox fight. Michelle Waterson, I mean, guys, she's quickly becoming one of my favorites. I don't know what you guys feel about her, but
basically,
you know,
his favorite solely off of looks, like it has zero to do with how good she can fight.
No.
She can fight.
Misha Tate's still my favorite.
But believe me, he's only liking the way she looks.
I'm not only liking the way she looks. I like the way she looks, and I like the way she punches. That's let's get that clear. But I don't know.
Carl say his favorite fighter is Gabby Garcia.
Wow. What, are you kidding me? She's bigger than
good
Cyborg.
Lord.
She's way bigger than Cyborg.
I know she is. She's that, like, yeah, she looks like a China almost.
Yeah.
Yes.
She doesn't have a twig and berries. She has like a soul pole and bowling
Jesus.
Balls or coconuts.
She's got an 18-wheeler riding between them legs.
She's the Mandinga of MMA.
Soul pole.
Absolutely.
Come on, ladies.
Absolutely.
Well, as usual, we're gonna take the beginning of the podcast while we still got these listeners before we make them all hang up with our disgusting talk about women. We're gonna plug our social media.
Do yourself, dude.
I'm just playing. Eat it. As usual, I want everybody listening right now to go on Facebook right now. And if you haven't already joined the group, 2-Minute Warning, join it. You'll enjoy your social media experience. It'll definitely get up. There's a lot of banter, a lot of back and forth. Mainly filled with good guys, but there is some clowns in there. You got to chin check every once in a while. But that makes the whole experience fun to me. I like calling people out and getting into these heated discussions, proving that I'm wrong, I'm right, and they're all wrong. That's usually what the case is. But aside from that, we want you guys to go right to Instagram as well and Twitter and follow us at Pride_Rules2MW, at Pride_Rules2MW. If you haven't already joined, if you haven't already subscribed to the YouTube, I know Omar is rigorously adding the shows, and you know, we got Chris in his onesies every once in a while posting those updates. But Omar has been
rigorous.
Omar's been working really hard
in his onesies.
Ouch.
I got rigorous. Exactly.
But he's been working hard to get the episodes up there, so they're getting all uploaded, and you know, it takes a while, so we can only really do, you know, one every few hours because the upload time.
That's crazy.
Regardless, follow us on social media. You got a lot of good memes. Our show links are posted there, all the archives, and you know, we keep you abreast on all the updated news and what's going on in the world.
Probably like the least casual fan out of all of us.
No, we'll touch on that when the douche calls. Believe me, I want to rip him a little bit for that. But,
casual fan out of all of us?
I think the least casual fan out of all of us, probably. Well,
that's
like,
what, yeah.
Homie hardcore Chris.
It's like winning, that's like winning a medal in the Special Olympics. You're still, you know, you're on the podium.
But, oh, man. Whoa.
Yeah. All right, before we absolutely lose every single caller, listener, fan of the show that there ever was, let's skip what we're about to talk about and jump right into the stories here. Oh, man, I love it.
Hey, man, let's talk about the big story with Cyborg getting caught with that needle in her ass again, huh?
Yeah, well,
but it's nothing bad.
We actually know what she popped for. What was the drug?
Nothing bad, though.
They didn't,
it's
they
acne
didn't say, they didn't
yeah,
say
she's
what
saying
they,
it's medical.
What she popped for yet. Yeah, medical.
It's dick
it's
pills.
Medical.
She's got
it's dick pills like John Jones. It's the same
The
same
TRT was also medical, you know?
Yo, we cannot
steer
clear of bashing women and their gender. We just can't
you know
get away from it.
It's not bashing anything. Every time I'm sitting there telling that, well, you know, she didn't want to fight for the 145 belt.
Stop interrupting with that weird shit.
Captain Interruption, just like all last week.
Yeah, you should talk, motherfucker.
We're
already in mid-show form.
Mid-show form, a minute and a half in.
She turned down two fights at 145, saying that she couldn't make the weight. No, she was just dirty. And I don't want to hear that.
That's right. She was on cycle.
She's saying it was for her recovery from her cut. That makes no sense. Makes no sense. She's definitely going to pop for
recovering
something
from
that.
I said, Carl, that's what I said to you before. I said, I guarantee you it has nothing to do with like pop a juice situation. It's more or less like a diuretic or like a weight cut situation. And I was right.
Right.
Well, that's what she's saying. It doesn't
I mean, like,
it
doesn't matter what she says. It's all going to get disclosed in due time, so she could say what she wants. USADA doesn't owe her a fucking goddamn thing. They're gonna say what they discovered, and it's gonna.
But
be
as
really
somebody
cool.
as somebody who popped twice, what do you think her suspension should be?
Yeah,
it
I don't
can't
know,
be 2 years.
Was she popped by USADA twice? No, I think that she was. This is like it's a good question. Because she was never under the UFC banner when she popped the first time.
Then it has nothing to do with it.
I know, but I'm just saying the UFC could defend her, you know, themselves if they wanted to.
In the fans' eyes,
she gets unheld Marys and just be sent home. That's really all we need to do. I want to see her fight. I don't care if she's 30.
That's her penance?
Just give her. Exactly. That's it.
Give a fight at what weight?
Send her on her way.
I can guarantee you this. Any fight with Ronda is now never happening because Ronda's just looking for any excuse to not fight this dude. So
yeah, all right.
No way.
Oh,
try
no.
Now that she's got her reason not to fight
him. I don't know. I think she's, I don't know. I was never a fan of hers to begin with. When she beat the piss out of Gina Carano, that bothered me back in the day.
Yeah.
Hey,
you
don't
know?
Talk about my girl like that.
I know, that's right
here,
right there.
We're
I
all
was
on
saying
the same page here that
off.
We were upset about Gina losing that fight to that fucking...
Yeah, really. You can tell he's a 49er fan because he doesn't know a damn thing.
Oh, my Lord.
That's right.
Oh, my Lord.
That's right.
Yeah, all right. He reached deep for that one.
Can I ask you a question? How the hell do we start with this stupid Cyborg story? I couldn't care less about her right now. She's not relevant in my eyes. What I want to talk about is this whole Conor, Aldo, Max Holloway fiasco that's going on. I've been meaning to sink my claws into Tommy's friggin' soul so friggin' much over this past day, ever since
that
last night.
Sexual, man.
That's,
well, you can dig your claws into whatever the hell you want because it's 2-2 because Omar said he agreed with everything that I was saying yesterday.
Well, then I'm going to sink my teeth into Omar, too,
dude,
because...
First of all, I don't even think you agree with what you were saying yesterday.
Absolutely, I do. Absolutely,
now, like, what,
usually I
got to
pay extra.
Here's my point,
clubs.
Tommy.
Like, where
is
are you
that,
giving it away for free? Like,
here's
amazing.
My point, Tommy, that Jose Aldo is in one breath saying, Conor was never the true champion at featherweight because he never defended the belt, right?
Okay.
And now... He's like, I was never not the champion because Conor never defended the belt, blah, blah, blah. So now Jose Aldo has just gift-wrapped the belt for Christmas. They handed it to him. You didn't even have to beat anybody for it, right?
Because he was crying like a bitch.
Now he's talking about moving up to the weight class that Conor McGregor is in, right, and not defending the same belt that he's bashing Conor for, and in the same breath and then saying, yes, but I'm still the champion. So wait, Conor's not the champion because he never defended, but you're allowed to have a belt that you didn't even earn, and then you haven't defended, and now you're going up and you're still the champion. That's all I don't get. It's just, like, I don't know what there is to defend. It's just, it's point blank, cut and dried.
Although
being a hypocrite.
He had that belt ever since the featherweight division was brought into the UFC.
No, he didn't. He lost it when he got fucking knocked unconscious with a left hand.
Okay, he lost it. He lost it from Conor, but he had it and defended it that whole time before that.
Do you hear yourself? Do you hear yourself?
No, but he didn't defend it now. He won the belt back by beating nobody.
Okay.
And then hasn't defended it, and now he's moving
up. Holloway has an ankle injury. He pulled out of 208, which, okay,
wait,
he wasn't signed, but they were going to fight.
They were never going to fight. Oh, Jose,
bro.
He said in the post-Octagon interview, in the post-fight, he said it, Jose Aldo, Brooklyn, 208. And then in the press conference, 10 minutes after, he was like, I can't actually do that. Like, he was like, I just looked. It's too short. Too close. He never was agreeing to that fight to begin with. He said it in the Octagon, and that did. There was never, you know, he said, I'm good to go for March. He didn't pull out. Fight him in March.
Listen, all I'm saying
is...
Okay,
so why should... Why should he fight him in March if there's a chance for him to fight for the belt at 55? Just
I'm
like
not
you
saying
said
he
with
should.
Conor.
What I'm saying is he's now going against everything that he said and everything that you criticized Conor for doing. Now you're saying, why should he? You know what I mean? What he's doing, you know, like... You're basically, you know, being the same hypocrite that he is by saying that he should do that after you just bashed the guy for doing the same thing.
That's what I want to say. That's what I want to bring up. It's not what do you mean so? It's not that. It's the fans. It's these Conor haters that when Conor was running from Aldo or running from Frankie or running from the 45 division, going all over, you know, fighting at 55, fighting Nate at 70 twice, and now bashing him for that, but when Aldo does it, it's not as much of a problem. It's clearly the only reason why you were saying it at the time was because you're hating on Conor without a clear thought to yourself. It's driven by hate. It's not. There's no background opinion backing your argument up. It just doesn't make sense. I don't hate Aldo
we're not
for
even
going
saying
up.
That Aldo shouldn't do it. I would do
right,
it.
That's what I'm saying.
Aldo, if he has the opportunity, do it.
I don't hate Aldo for doing it. I hate the fans and the people and Aldo for bashing one guy for doing it and then making it okay for the next guy.
The thing is, he's really, like, I think that he's not that bright, dude. Like, saying what he's saying,
no,
like, I don't know
well, nobody ever said
how
he was bright.
Like, hypocritical he sounds.
Well, because everybody Man. Wants to see that fight again. Everybody wants to see that fight.
Who?
I don't care about that fight.
I want to see Aldo and Holloway fight.
Whoa.
That's what I want to see.
I want to see that fight again.
I'm looking, excuse me, but I'm looking at an article that was written yesterday that says ankle injury keeping Holloway out of UFC.
Yeah, and if you read that,
right, because he can't recover quick enough.
I know what article you're looking at, and it's not once does that's all based off of Jose Aldo's comments. That's not like
yeah,
that's
but there's
not
nothing signed for 208. There's fights talked about. That was one of the fights that were talked about.
Talked about.
It's impossible. If he literally started his fight camp today, he still wouldn't have 2 months, 8 weeks to get ready. Plus, he's injured. He can't. There's no contact allowed for Holloway right now.
So talking about fights like in the media and actually like signing like yo, Khabib and Aldo were talked about. You know what I mean? Like, does that mean that they were set to fight? You know, like, obviously, Aldo was – Khabib was offered Aldo at 55 for the interim belt. That was according to what Aldo was saying, and that he's like a lightweight, turned it down because his father said it wasn't the right fight. Now, we all know who he's talking about because what other lightweight would they offer him, you know, for an interim belt?
Khabib.
Whose father would be involved. It's clearly Khabib. You know,
right.
So
well,
they were like,
we'll get to Khabib in a minute.
He doesn't want me to say anything, but his father turned down the fight. So basically, he said something.
Khabib's
you know, like,
father could fight in the UFC right now. Let's not also forget
no,
that he might
I
be
know.
Getting a two-fighter deal. All right? Let's be serious.
Yeah, Pettinaris.
Could probably put a beating on half the heavyweight.
I would love to see if that fuck Pettinaris up.
100%. Oh, you know what? They should have like a coaches league. Honest to God, I want to see Greg Jackson in there. Get his ears kicked off.
I think
Greg Jackson
would probably do well. Kavanaugh would do well.
Yeah. I think Rufus would do well. What do you guys think?
He might be a little.
I think Duke would do okay.
Yeah, he's Matt, a little hefty in the belly.
I think he's getting subbed quick because if you don't, he don't have the fucking the win to last on the mat. As soon as that goes,
Ludwig. I think Ludwig might do pretty well.
Ludwig really well.
Here's the tweets here's the tweets from Max Holloway. So Waldo is saying he always shows up, and me and Conor are two-faced, and Khabib won't fight him. Hashtag no way, Jose. His next tweet, the issue with Waldo is not about turning down fights, it's that he doesn't show up. Hashtag no Jose Aldo. Last one, wherever Waldo is hiding, they must not have internet. And then Sucker Punch Entertainment, Max's management team, posted a picture of the swollen bruised ankle saying the doctor won't allow contact for weeks. So at that, right there, taking those facts right there, it doesn't matter what Max said. He could say whatever he wants right after the fight. The doctors won't allow him to any contact. So, all right, fine. He can train his cardio or whatever. But that's not a true fight camp. Once he's allowed contact, it's 8 weeks, right?
Yeah,
I mean, you want to give a guy a full fight camp. That's what I don't understand, Tommy. You know fighting. I don't understand why
I can't believe you're saying that fight was set and that Max pulled out or whatever. Like, that's crazy to me. Dude, you're just tailoring your argument as far as I see.
He's not allowed to fight.
You could say I'm tailoring whatever I want. It doesn't matter. Your problem is me not being pissed off because Aldo wants to go up a division
Conor.
My problem was you hating Conor for doing it and not hating Aldo for doing it. It's just the difference. You either hate both or like both. It's got to be consistent. That's my point. You clearly don't like Conor, which I respect. That's fine.
This is America, guys. Hold on. You either hate both or like both. No. I mean, the man's a multifaceted man of the people. Tommy can have differing opinions.
He can flip-flop all he wants. That's America.
Who's flip-flopping? I don't like Aldo one bit. I can't stand Aldo, but I do want to see that fight again because I think that fight goes longer than 13 seconds.
Yeah,
all right,
course.
So that's the only reason why you're okay with it because you want to see the
fight
again.
Well.
Yeah,
it's got to be the right fight, you know?
There's too many fights made right now or about to be made for these things to happen in the UFC. Holloway is the interim title holder, so he's now next in line to fight Jose. Jose has a bone to pick or has a stupid – he's just so hell-bent on chasing Conor around because he wants to avenge his victory, which isn't going to happen in my eyes, first of all. Second of all, he's going to go up and fight for the 55 – like, clearly, Khabib and Ferguson deserve that match to fight for the interim title, and then the winner gets Conor. Why is Aldo
– I like Jose.
Aldo is delusional, bro. He's fucking gone. And the thing is, it's really risky to put Aldo in there against any of these guys because a lot goes into this, a lot of money. And then, really, the fact is, dude, like, he's probably going to pull. Like, that's the thing. It's like
what I was saying yesterday. That's what I was saying yesterday. No matter what fight gets set, he's going to pull out.
That's my point. So like, these guys want to go, let me fucking sign up to fight him. It's like, who do I really train for now? You know, like,
They should do it like the old K-1 fight.
Sign to fight Aldo, and you really don't know if you're actually going to get Aldo, you know?
They have one right there. They have one waiting. All right, like Badr Hari, you know, just chilling in the back, being like, I'll fight anybody. Like,
I'm willing to bet that, let's say, that fight did get set at 55 and Aldo pulled out. I'm willing to bet 2 years' salary on it, Frankie Edgar would call Dana White and say, I'll take the fight at 55.
Of course he would.
Guaranteed.
I would take that fight at 55 at that point.
That's a title shot at 55, dude, for fucking stepping in.
I would take it for 2 years' salary because my man Tommy is making more money than Jesus right now with all the overtime.
That's what I'm talking about.
It's great New York. All right?
Let me get that salary.
You want to know where's Waldo?
Yeah.
Where's Tommy?
How you doing?
Tommy. Jesus.
Yeah, where's Tommy?
We go from this 45 division goes from, you know, this whole mess with Conor having the belt and Aldo being the number one contender. You got Holloway, Mendez, Frankie, Pettis. The division was looking strong. Conor bounces, goes to 55. All those chasing him to 55. Chris is, you know, a believer that Mendez and Frankie are going to wind up going down the division just because, I mean, the division is quickly becoming a joke. They give the title to a guy that was knocked out in 13 seconds who everyone's bashing, and he's chasing around in divisions. How about calling Conor out saying, come back down and fight at 45, and we'll see who really gets the belt. Like, don't chase him to the 55.
If Conor's talking all this mess like, don't believe what you see on the internet, I don't care, blah, 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 then clearly he's got plans to go back down still. Otherwise, why is he saying it?
Well, but
he's
I
not
don't think
going
his,
back down, dude. He's not
well,
going
I,
back down.
I don't think his. I don't think he's going to shut the door. He's not going to shut the door on that verbally in an interview, but I don't know. Like, you know, Kavanaugh says it. He doesn't really think it's healthy for him. I mean, of course not, but look at Conor's figure. He looked awful. I mean, I don't know if he can make 45 anymore. He's getting older.
Ultimately, it's Conor's choice, though. It doesn't matter what these guys say. Conor is still hell-bent on you know, the fact that he's a two-division champ. If that's the case, then he clearly has plans to go back down there and fight for that belt again.
55 and 70. Get 55 and 70. Make him a two-division champ at 55 and 70 and have at one time held three belts. He would retire as the greatest of all time.
I mean,
he would retire
as
the greatest of all time, and then Carl could go to sleep at night happy. Like, then we'd all be...
Sleep? I wouldn't be able to sleep. There'd be a box of sticky tissues next to my bed.
Carl would put a whole mattress with Vaseline.
Let me just glance over that real quick.
I could see him dropping. Oh, come on.
Oh, God.
While we're talking about the 170 division real quick, and we discussed the whole the welterweight division, while what's the deal with Willie, dude? I mean, why does he continue to bring, like, the race card? He tries to be, like, He compared MMA and what Conor did to bringing, like, the Ferguson out in it. This is riots based off murders where people were killed, cops were sniped in another state. Like, what is wrong with him? How could you say the stupid shit that he says and still be allowed to, like, cover the sport in the media? I mean, I don't get it. Like,
I don't know that.
Like, Tommy said.
I think there's a happy medium there. Like, I don't think it's the best thing to say, but I don't think he needs to be stripped of his job because of it. He didn't.
No. Not stripped of his job, but, like, there should be, like, a fine or something. Like, dude, chill out with that. Like, that's – people really died. It's not just a fight where there's a ref steps in and stops it.
The thing is, though, he grew up in Ferguson. So it's not like, you know, he's referring to it as if, like, yo, you know, like.
What happened in Ferguson aside from these riots? And, you know, like, there was nothing. You didn't even know where Ferguson was.
Yeah, but that doesn't mean anything.
You know, 2 years ago.
Yo, like, if he grew up in Compton, he would have said, you bring the Compton out in me. If he would have grew up in Paterson, New Jersey, they would have said, yo, you brought the Paterson out in me. Like, I don't think that has anything to do with what actually took place in Ferguson. I just think that because he grew up.
I think you're wrong.
I mean, he did grow up.
Because there was nothing. There was nothing. What was Ferguson before the riots? It was nothing.
It was where he grew up, though. It was that, at the very least.
It was a great
town. It's his hometown.
I had great diners, and I loved the pastrami sandwiches down there. I don't know about you guys.
I think what he was trying to say is, like, you're going to bring the hood out in me. You know,
he's not hood. Enough of that hood. You're not hood anymore, bro. You've been trained.
Yeah, I know, but
you're an MMA fighter.
You're going
to
bring it
you
out.
Don't bring guns to the cage. This is ridiculous.
Yeah, but
he's
trying. Yeah, but you're trying.
We don't know.
You're asking him.
I'm not going up to Woodley and saying, "Listen."
you're trying to figure out a guy who said that Joe Rogan had underlying racism when he said that Woodley was so big and strong that he would gas early. Woodley said that that's underlying racism.
I wanted to mention.
Like, if he was like, Woodley's so big and strong that he can't even swim, then that would be racism. But
that's still not racist. There has nothing to do with
really
racism.
This is what this guy does. He wants to be the center of everything. He wants to be the talk.
He's the Colin Kaepernick of MMA. He wants to be that guy.
He pulls that card a little bit too much, and it's ridiculous.
Way too much.
and it's dumb.
Yeah.
And, you know, I mean, the guy did get knocked out by Nate Marquardt.
I was just going to say that, dude. Literally took the words out of my fucking mouth.
And I wanted to mention that before, because, Tommy, you've been saying this for weeks now. You actually brought it up over a month ago, how he brings the race card into it way too much. And we get it. Like, there's been oppression in, you know, in that specific race or culture. But, dude, that has nothing to do with it here. Why even try to bring that in? You're fighting in a sanctioned fight with, you know, where you train. These guys have a specific art, a tactic, a skill. There's nothing hood about it. There's no drive-bys. There's no,
roll up on anybody. As a member of the Brown delegation.
I think they were putting too much into this, really,
like
to be honest.
Cut off, Parker. Watch someone get a thought out.
As the minority reporter here, I got to say that if you bring up the card too much, it's almost like you cry wolf. You know what I mean?
I see it on
like Telemundo when my mom's watching, you know, her stories. I see it, you know, if a race or a culture decries it way too much, it loses the poignancy that it can have when it's a legitimate issue.
It has the opposite effect when you're trying to actually 100%. Do something positive for it.
Exactly. So if something happens down the road where, like, Woodley has a legitimate gripe in terms of, like, hey, when
it's
I was
gonna be,
you know,
it's going to be like, oh, here we go again.
Yeah, exactly. You know, like, hey, I didn't get paid the same as GSP, and I can bring in all the sponsors. Saying in a perfect world, I know that's not the case, but say, for example, you know, just for ha-has, he could say that. Like, if he had a legitimate gripe, nobody's going to pay attention. So that's what pisses me off. I mean, I get pissed off because he's bringing it up. There are legitimate gripes that I think you could use that soapbox for because he is a public figure.
Absolutely.
But you're throwing it away.
In this particular case, all he said was, you know, he almost brought the Ferguson. I almost went Ferguson on him, on his ass, talking about Conor.
That's horrible.
He didn't really pull a race card here. He just, you know, kind of said something stupid.
No. But yeah, but
it's charged,
talking hood.
If I go, hey, you're going to bring out the Puerto Rican Day Parade in me, I know as a Puerto Rican that there's certain things I should not say. I can get away with saying that. I grew up in Queens. And, you know, Puerto Rican Day Parade was lit, but there was one where they rape people, you know, in the streets. I know that. And I can't say that and expect to be taken seriously on an issue that is serious. Like, I do want to hear what Woodley has to say about the issue, you know, as a man of color. Like, hey, listen, please chime in. Educate us if you can. But if you use up that social currency that you have as a public figure on stupid things, maybe he said it as an offhanded comment. Maybe he did. I don't think he did. And even if he did, I think he should have a little more – he should have a little more wherewithal to say, hey, listen, that's a charged issue. I should only pull that thing out of the chamber if it's really a shot I want to shoot.
Good use.
I'm really glad you said that. That was actually a good little paragraph there. It really explained the situation well, what's happening, because – you know, as a public figure, you do have a voice. So sometimes nowadays, everyone's so quick to, like, oh, I want to get my opinion heard, that they oversaturate it. And that's what's happening. And you're exactly right, because when something happens where you actually need him to use his voice to speak out on a matter, to maybe bring social change, or maybe to bring some perspective to it, or put it under the microscope for change, it's now nothing, because everyone's looking at you like, ah, whatever. I won't even read the article anymore because I'm so sick of reading the same stuff. It angers me.
The next thing he says, right? The next thing he says is like, oh, it's just Woodley being Woodley.
Exactly.
When it could be something serious.
Right, and I'm not going to want to hear, oh, racism this, racism that. Stop it, dude. You're the champion.
No.
There's African champions all over the place. There's been African champions since day one. One of the best fighter pound for pound right now on the list is African.
Focus more on something like that. Has more relevance to
whatever. He brought up Woodley, and I wanted to bring that up because I'm seeing stories. If you look at if you Google MMA news,
I guarantee
you
didn't end up spending 15 minutes talking about Woodley.
We didn't spend 15 minutes, but you know, I want everyone to get their word out.
I hate when this happens when someone jumps on the show
like, oh, I don't think we should talk about this anymore. Well, that's your
opinion. I just don't think that we
don't
really
say nothing.
You know, like, we're fucking, you know, trying to speak.
Well,
I'll call you when we
meet
white guys, and like, what the fuck do we know about what they go through? To be honest, you know.
I know plenty. I know exactly what's going on with this specific issue.
I'm not gonna chime in on it. Where I have no.
That's all.
I'll knock on the door. I'll knock on the door when we start talking about the Diaz brothers. But so honestly though, like this whole Conor Aldo Holloway thing, what should happen is Aldo should fight Holloway March 3rd, March 4th, whatever the hell he's talking about. Oh, I can't remember the date of the fight I signed. What are you, nuts? You don't remember if it's 3rd or 4th? Who cares? That's irrelevant. Fight Holloway. Let Khabib fight Ferguson. And then the winners sort each other out. Then we have fights in place. We have champions. Unify the 45 strap first, and then worry about going up and fighting Conor. You were just handed a belt. You should then want to show people, hey, look, I deserve this by beating somebody in the 45 division. You should.
Jose Aldo wants to move up. He should have to forfeit his belt immediately. Max's belt should.
But Conor didn't have to. Conor didn't have.
Yeah,
to
but he was given. It was given to him
matter.
Though. That's why, Tommy.
Doesn't
it was
matter.
Given to him.
He never won that belt.
It's a Christmas ornament. That belt means nothing right now.
Right.
He cried.
If he won it, I get that. If he won it, let him hold it, I get it. But if you want to jump around and chase people, then you don't deserve it.
The difference is there's only one Conor McGregor. Everybody wants to do what he did, but not everybody's doing what he did. Not everybody brings in the numbers he brings in. So you can't just say, oh, Conor did it, I'm going to do it. No, it doesn't work that way. It does not work that way. You don't make the decisions. You know what I mean? Conor does.
He was awarded special privileges by bringing in that much money. I get that. And although he did plenty for the sport. He helped it grow a decade ago, but still.
Aldo did a lot for the sport, but Aldo doesn't sell fights well. He doesn't do those things that Conor does. You know, he doesn't.
I agree.
Well, he doesn't sell fights. The problem why he doesn't sell fights is because he always gets hurt. That's
and because he's and because it's just not his style. He don't like he's very.
And he doesn't
like,
speak English.
I swear I was just gonna say I think the language barrier has something to do with that.
Of course it does. Of course it does.
So I can't really fault him for that, but you're right.
He fights in Brazil too. I don't see him. You know, he's fought in Brazil. I don't see him like really selling. I just don't see it. I'm sorry. I don't see it.
No. I guess there's a lot of pasty ginger. There's more pasty gingers than Brazilians, I guess. I don't know.
Oh, my Lord. Wow.
Damn, hey,
okay.
I'll tell you right now. We're talking racism. We might as well go full-fledged into it. Both those ethnicities stand behind their fighters well. The Irish come out for Ireland fighters, and Brazilians come out for Brazilian fighters. So, you know, hey, I mean, I don't think there's any angle there where one has the advantage. I think they both are fine. It's just this sport is an American sport, so that's why the UFC is based. It started in America.
The UFC is not the sport, though. UFC is an organization, dude. The sport is the most international sport.
That's what I meant.
Chris is. Chris
UFC
is not a casual
is American.
Fan. I just want to let
Chris is
know.
Not a casual fan.
Look out.
You know who's a casual fan? My drunk aunt. She's a casual fan.
The least,
she is a casual fan.
Definitely the least hardcore out of all of us is me, probably. I'm like the most casual.
You're the toughest, best fan. Yeah, not question. All right. On the flip side of that, you know, jumping to the other side of the controversial issues that are going on right now with these two weight classes, the whole Khabib Ferguson mess. Are you guys watching what's going on social media with these two? Apparently, they're jabbing back and forth at each other. Right now, it's really a money thing. You know, there's some tweets. You know, Ferguson tweets, I was ready for January, Ace, talking to Khabib. Your puss had too much sand in it from the last fight. You talked too much with a crying emoji, laughing crying emoji. And then Khabib went back at him. You know, they're kind of going back and forth right now. Khabib's talking about a fight with Aldo, saying he's the one that turned it down. The reason why he turned it down is because he won't bully the little, is what he said in quotes. Ferguson said, stop playing games. You told Dana that you wanted to fight, and your manager isn't answering the phone. I'm done. No more talking. He answered. I answered. Both accepted. Now I need fair terms. Clearly, he wants more money. Khabib saying the fans are asking for the fight. It's the best thing that could happen in the lightweight division today. Stop hiding and accept the challenge. Be a man. And then Ferguson finally came back and said, Dana must have paid you good with your new deal. You're being fairly paid. Now it's my turn. I want this fight, but I won't take peanuts for it. So it looks like that fight should be happening. It's just Ferguson's now jockeying for the money. And you never saw this before, Conor. So what he did, right, it's leverage. When you have the chance, strike while the iron's hot, because he can lose this next fight and then not get his deal. Look at Alvarez. If Alvarez would have struck gold and wanted to sign a new contract when he fought Conor, he'd be a lot richer than he is today. He turns around, loses the fight. Now he's going to start from scratch and build himself all the way back up again and probably never get the money he could have made in that one fight.
I mean, he got a nice chunk of money in that. He made over a mil, but... You know, he definitely should have used that leverage to restructure his contract. The minute
that's
why he's a champ, he should have said, I'm not fighting again until I get a new deal. That's it.
Yeah.
Right, and that's what Ferguson's doing right now. Listen, he's got the active fight win streak. If you were to ask a non-casual fan right now, who, you know, aside from Conor McGregor,
stop using that term.
I said it as a joke. Blow the shit out of
him. I know.
Those two fighters right now are at the top of their game. Like, these guys, like, that's who I want to see fight next. I don't care how boring Khabib is. I'm curious to see which one of those guys deserves the shot at Conor. Whoever wins the fight deserves the shot for the title. And until that fight happens, I don't think they should give either of them a shot at Aldo or Conor until they fight each other.
I want to see Nate Diaz slap the shit out of whoever they Out of those three guys, I think Nate deserves a title shot next. So I don't even know why.
Jesus Christ!
I mean,
God,
he deserves a title shot.
Tommy, Christ on the cross, right? You know what I'm saying?
Oh,
he just
shit.
Nate Diaz does not deserve a title shot until
happy birthday.
No, until Khabib and Ferguson get their shot first. Whoever wins that fight,
like, I've
fights
heard
Conor.
You say that 3 weeks ago, you said the opposite.
No. No, no, no.
No, he definitely didn't. I know he definitely didn't. Nate Diaz deserves a title shot.
Right, I agree. I love Nate Diaz. He's a good fighter. I think what he did this year specifically, after 25 fights in the UFC, now he's catapulting himself to superstardom because of the fights with Conor. He's at the top of his game right now, and he's fought a quarter of a century of fights in the UFC before that happened. That's unprecedented to fight that much and be misunderstood for your whole career, and now all of a sudden
he needs
because 26. Of what you did.
He needs 26. Stop it, all right?
Yeah,
25 isn't enough.
Well, right, yeah. But I'm just saying, like, it's unprecedented, but he doesn't deserve a title shot yet. I'm sorry, he doesn't.
He's being more liked now because he's not bashing the UFC every 5 minutes like he used to do.
Like
he was always bashing Dana White. He was always bashing the UFC.
But he had a right. He had a reason to. He was making fucking 10 to show and 10 to win for a long time as a really good fighter, you know?
Yeah, he was a really good fighter, but he didn't win when it really counted. He didn't win the lightweight belt.
He lost
one big fight, really. Like, you know, the title eliminator, I mean, the title shot he lost, all right. But he won other fights that mattered. Like, Jim Miller was a title eliminator, and he won that fight. That fight mattered, you know.
Yeah, but he didn't win enough of his fights to actually be looked at as a serious contender. I mean,
I know,
listen,
and he lost you. Lost to Gray Maynard the first time, and he really, you know, like a lot of these fights, he didn't really fuck.
Well, of course, he got screwed on a lot of decisions. I'll give him that, but hey, they say never leave it in the hands of the judges, whatever. I hate that statement. It's still a fight. You know, what are you supposed to do? You know,
it's
you're
a true
it
statement,
all.
Though.
Yeah,
it is, but what are you supposed to do?
Too.
You think that Nate left anything in the octagon there? Well, no, he tried his hardest to win that fight. It just didn't happen.
Gray Maynard, who got the win in the first fight, did he not? Should he have not left it in the hands of the judges either? You know, like they. Something.
Yeah, that's
no.
What I'm saying. It's tough. So you're right. No, but what are you going to do? I mean, 15 minutes is up. I mean, it's not like you can keep fighting. It's just the time is over, and you did what you had to do, and now let's see who won points. But, I mean, it brings us back to the discussion.
He didn't lose.
The scoring is fucked up. That's it.
He didn't lose, guys.
I mean, I guess it really is like, unless anybody else has really looked into it, the new unified rules for MMA that's going to be implemented this next month.
No, enlighten us. Speak on it.
It's the scoring. It's in depth. I don't unless you guys have also looked at it. It's kind of pointless.
I'm a casual fan, Chris. So I'm
sorry.
I don't get that.
Save this conversation until next week, possibly. I think that'll be better when we all have.
Well, why don't you brief us on it? There's no more 10-point must system. Is that what we're talking about?
See, like there's you got to read it, dude. It's the scoring is going to be different. It's not going to be like a. You know, they're just doing the way they score isn't going to be solely based on, like, laying and praying. You can't really do that anymore. I think they're going to, you know, stalling.
It won't matter unless we get judges that aren't ridiculously underqualified.
Dude, they're starting to implement, like, former fighters are, you know, they're doing
Thank God.
I agree.
I'm trying to think of the fighter that's actually applied for his license.
Well, Ricardo
basically,
Almeida
well, Chris,
is a judge.
Yeah, I was going to say, Almeida, I know, is now a judge. I think, who the fuck was it? It might have been Kenny Florian. Yeah.
You know what's hard with that, though? What's tough with that? You're going to have, you know, you got to be careful, because what if you have a fighter that you know, has some sort of ties to a fighter that
yeah,
fights on the card?
Yes,
that night.
That's why
you,
you
that.
Have a couple judges.
There's a
yeah,
lot of
even still, dude.
That.
Even still, I still think that guy who gave Nate a 10-8 round in the fifth might have had some money on Nate, because that was no 10-8 round in that second. I'm speaking facetiously.
There was an envelope involved. No, I'm not. I'm being completely honest. There was an envelope that changed hands.
Am I not crazy by thinking, how could you score that a 10-8 round for Nate? I mean, dude, are you out of your mind? A 10-8 round is sustained damage, almost winning a fight, coming real close,
like,
and beating him up
the
round
convincingly, but it was not a 10-8 round.
It was not a 10-8 round.
Yeah.
So Conor won all those. In my eyes, he won on every card, 3-2, he should have. But, you know, whatever. What are you going to do? These judges that you leave it in the hands of, what are you going to do?
Did Tommy have a show?
You know, it's
that's
funny.
Usually his cue to jump in and say something.
Right.
Are you okay?
I've been waiting for him. I've been waiting for him to jump in. I'm trying to piss him off.
It's funny when you say that about the 10-8 round, because there's not that many 10-8 rounds that are given, but when they are, it's a joke. When they are, it just doesn't make any sense. It
right.
makes no sense whatsoever.
Yeah, yo, like, I'm pretty sure, like, the Forrest Griffin-Tito fight, the first one, that first fight, the first round, was probably the worst ass-whooping I've ever seen in my life. Tito Ortiz destroyed Forrest Griffin for the first round, and it was a 10-9 round. Right? And then, like, when Forrest Griffin fought Rampage, he got, like, two 10-8 rounds or something. They were bullshit. It was, you know, it was...
Yeah,
it's the whole system needs, even with this change, it's probably going to take a while for it to actually make sense to everybody.
Yeah, but you know what? I like the fact that there's effort to fix the things that people are clamoring about, you know, because even when you got guys like, yo, you got Dana White bitching about the scoring and the shit, you know, he's the president of the biggest, you know, organization in the world. It's like, it would be like Roger Goodell bitching about the way they, you know, score
it's
the NFL.
It's so weird. It's so weird you just brought up Roger Goodell, because I was going to say the best thing about the NFL is their adaptability to the rule changes. They've changed rules yearly since the game came into play. That's what's keeping it currently like one of the best sports, because you don't have these archaic rules.
Yeah,
in
you
got to
adjust, man. You got to adjust with the times, not just the times. Like, you live and you learn. Just because it was one way, you know, that doesn't mean it was the right way.
Exactly. Exactly. I don't get it. I think they're doing the right thing by trying to fix it. Hey, it might take a while. It might even need multiple tweaking over time. Who cares? At least try it. Make
pride
the sport
rules.
Better for what it is. Pride rules.
Forget
Give it the pride rules,
rules,
baby.
Right.
Pride rules, baby.
We're ahead of the curve.
I love it. I love it, Omar. Yo, what's
as
up
much
with
as
you?
I loved it would never happen in the U.S. ever again.
Of course not.
You know?
Of course
it
not.
Would never, ever happen.
Never. It would never. And we,
you know,
I don't
know what thinking, dude. Dude, what about, like, guys, what about, like, different rules when they
just
fight in other countries?
So McCain dies. And then we got this. What do you think? I think if we can replace somebody in Arizona, take that Senate seat, Republican, Democrat, I don't care. As long as he's an MMA fan, we can vote.
Well,
in.
It was also,
okay,
yeah, but it was pay-per-view, too. It was pay-per-view, too. That was, you know, they had to restructure the rules because pay-per-view would
weight
show.
Classes, they had to put on
and
gloves.
Chris, to touch on what you said, what happens
ahead.
If there's a fight? What happens if there's a fight in another country? It's like having these football games in London. Like, you're not going to make a 110-yard field. You're not going to have Canadian rules football when it's in Europe. You know, that's the reason, I think, why they keep the rules the same, because it's still the same organization. You know, the rules got to be in place for – it's just consistency. You got to keep consistency.
It's that, but you know what else? Okay. What else it is, I mean, it was awesome watching those pride fights, but it definitely is a lot – more safer for the fighters, you know.
Without question.
I mean, you got to think of it this way. You're going to go for a takedown on a guy just like Mirko Krokop. Now, he stuffs that takedown. You're in turtle position, and he's on your back.
Yeah, but
you're
here's
eating
the thing
knee
that
to
makes
the top
you think
of your head.
Twice about that takedown.
Right.
You know, it is
a
fight after
exactly.
All, you know?
Exactly.
No,
but
he
you
said.
What?
Different tiddlywink.
It's more longevity for these fighters. I mean, you look at Gary Goodridge now, and I've said this before – The guy can't even remember a quarter of his career. And he had a pretty damn long career.
No, but I get it, and it's a shame, but this is the fucking thing that they signed up for, man. It's not like...
The hurt business, guys.
Yeah, you know?
Right.
Like, this is not,
they're also making...
They're out there, each of these guys, you know, you see Dan Henderson knocks Bisping out, clear, out, cold, and drops, like, two more bombs on him. Like, that's...
Yo, that pisses me off,
God bless him.
Yeah, that was unnecessary.
For real, though,
that... Unnecessary.
That was awful.
But you can't, You can't say Bisping didn't deserve it.
Nobody deserves that, dude. That should be, that's like an assault, yo. You should be,
But
if that was Pride rules, he could have got foot stomped right on the face. So what's the difference?
Yeah. Well, that's, we're agreeing
what's
with you. It can never happen. I'm agreeing
so
it can never happen.
I'm saying that, like, when somebody's out cold, like that, you shouldn't drop another bomb on them.
The referee should have dove on top of him. That's
you're right about
done.
That. That's the ref's responsibility. All right, so who do we got online here?
Once again, how we doing, gentlemen?
What's up?
Oh my God, the first half of this show sucked so bad that I had to down a bottle of Jameson and I was just about to slip my wrist with a broken shard of it.
Oh my God, dude.
You wouldn't know which way to cut that.
Terrible.
You shouldn't joke about suicide, bro.
Yeah, around this time of the year, you really
joke.
Shouldn't
he'll
do
like
that.
He'll like talk bad about like gay people, and then he'll be like killing himself, and you know.
He's just drunk. When you drink that much alcohol, Chris.
Mr. Fucking Hardcore himself, Peter Abatanto.
No government names on here. Hey, listen. Chris, how you feel about Nate Diaz? He wants $20 million a fight.
Yeah, how do we not talk about that? Good call, Pete. What's up, Chris?
$20 million Nate wants. You think he's worth it?
He wants to shoot for the stars, man.
You ever hear the Rolling Stones song where you can't always get what you want, but if you try, sometimes you get what you need. You know,
right,
like,
no, I mean, I'm not hating on him for it, but
$20 million. Clearly,
that's
kind of, you know, it's like going to the pawn shop. You know, you ask for $200 knowing that, you know, they're only giving you $100 tops, but, you know.
The best I can do is $45.
Is that how it works, Carl?
Best I can do.
Exactly.
I don't watch Pawn Stars. That show pisses me off. But,
it's funny because it seems like after this McGregor fight, I mean, he got obviously paid off for the first one and then paid off for the second one, but it's like, is Nate Diaz worth McGregor money?
No.
You know what I mean? Like, is he equivalent to...
He's not worth it, but not entitled to try for it?
Exactly. That's what I'm saying. Like, dude, just another guy that Conor changed his career by making him think a certain way. He earned money fighting Conor, so now Nate thinks he deserves that money, and he did... He did blast into superstardom. He's now more of a household name because of the Conor fights. And all this stuff is happening because of the residuals are happening because of this Conor fight.
Nate Diaz is
someone sniffing something?
Nate Diaz is the biggest draw.
He's
doing
a couple
of
bumps to get his head straight. That's all.
He's got to level out.
What are we talking about here? Are we talking about somebody doing...
I was sniffing a cheap hooker's ass. My bad.
Outside of Conor McGregor, Nate
payday,
definitely
boys.
The biggest draw in the lightweight division. So, you know, who else?
He ain't worth $20 million. I mean, I would go as far as saying maybe giving him 8 or 9.
Nobody's saying
he
deserves $20 million, but I don't even think he thinks that. But like I said, you shoot for shit that you know you ain't going to get. This way, like... I don't blame him for trying.
He said it to a guy in an interview, and that's it. He said it to a guy in an interview, and they ran with it, man.
Like, his managers are gonna sign for the most that they could get, and that's what they're gonna sign for. They're gonna hold out and get as much as possible. And I don't.
But it's like, who does he? If he doesn't fight McGregor next, like, who does he fight that he's gonna be worth even half of that? Like, you know what I mean? Like, who?
Cyborg.
Is he that big of a draw on his own? You know what I mean? I don't think Nate's that big of a draw on his own.
No, I don't. I'll tell you this. Look, if Nate Diaz was fighting Alvarez, would you not be souped for it? Yeah, I think you're nowhere near as good as fighting. I think you're discrediting how much of a draw Nate actually is.
Well, no, I'm not discrediting. I'm just questioning it. So I'm interested now because, you know what I mean? Like, now that he got that type of money for the Conor fight, I think he's going to be expecting to make millions. But it's like he went from, what, $40,000 to whatever he made for the McGregor fight?
$3 million. Well, that's the thing. He needs to realize that he didn't do that on his own.
Right.
But it's somewhere in the middle. Chris, you clearly are a Diaz fan. I am too, but I'm more of a realist when it comes to it. Pete, you know, I think it's in the middle of both your arguments. He kind of deserves somewhere in the middle. Like,
my argument is exactly what you just said. I didn't say he deserved that. I'm saying that he's the biggest draw outside of McGregor in the lightweight division, though. That's all.
I think he needs that money to pay off his big brother's fines. I think that's his deal.
Honestly, is somebody dying on the phone? I think that's you, Pete. It's really, you're like, every 2 seconds I hear like,
I told
like
you,
an
bro.
Oxygen
his
machine.
His name's Bukkake Pete. There's a train all around him.
Oh,
you know what I mean?
He's just taking it.
Good
you know, this is wilding. We are wilding today.
Yeah, let's reel it in here.
No, I don't like – let's go right off the rails. Yo, what's up with Holly Holm, Pete? You had a Holly Holm argument you wanted to bring up? Like, anyone give a shit about this fucking
– Yeah, nobody really does give a shit, but I think it's kind of crazy. I mean, now they – well, now that Cyborg might have popped USADA test, but my whole thing with that was, like, how do you have Holly Holm, who's coming off two losses at bantamweight, and then you take Jermaine Duranemi, whoever the – like
– Look, Holly Holm is warranted.
De Randami. Yeah. Come on, man. At least
Randami. Randami.
She is warranted.
Please.
Holly Holm might have been warranted.
You fucking douche. Oh, Jesus. I love it.
They made the 145 division basically because Cyborg couldn't make weight. So it's like now
and
you
she can't
take
make
two other girls.
Either.
She can't, right. She can't make 145 either. But I honestly think that it. One division doesn't have anything to do with the next. If they're creating a new division, you got to throw. You can't say, "Oh, she's ranked eighth." I get it coming off of two losses, but oh, she's ranked eighth. So how could she be a serious contender in this division? It's a new division. It has nothing to do with the rankings of your previous division. That's the issue there.
It's the
so
same,
a lot of people
it's
are
the
look,
same argument. I go back to it like with Nate.
Yeah,
like,
but then how could you say that Nate?
He's been
that
doing
Nate
it
can't...
for a long time, man. Like these guys don't have to like fight their way back up the ranks when you're that established.
I'll give you
but
that.
You gotta
I get it.
You got to look at Holmes' past couple fights. You know, the fight against Misha, that
was
her
winning.
Fight. She made a mistake at the end. You know, that was all that was. She was basically beating the
shit.
Yeah,
and honestly, I don't know that she even lost this other fight to that other chick, the Shevchenko chick.
Nah, she lost.
Yeah.
She lost. That chick
I didn't get to
control.
Watch it, like, full.
Yeah, I watched it.
I thought you were
that
I thought you were a
control.
Hardcore fan, though, Chris. Come on, man. Get the tape out.
No, I'm the
got
least.
Got him
right.
Got him.
Come on.
I'm the least.
Come on.
I'm the least hardcore. I told you that.
But yeah, no,
let me bury this an hour and a half into our show. I read Ariel Helwani on his Twitter account.
What's his name?
Said that they're
Helwani. What did you just call him? Did you turn him into a Turk? I think
he's
a
racist
Canadian. What did you turn him into?
I don't know. I read it very literal as to how it's spelled, I guess. But regardless, he posted a link saying that they're actually going to show the 206 card in its entirety or a two-hour version of it. So we'll get
right.
to see these fights for free. So I think that's pretty cool. Look for that on Christmas Eve. But like I said, I just buried that in the middle of nothing. No one's going to even get that. But
anybody who has Twitter saw Dana White tweet that today. So, you know.
Oh,
okay.
He did. All
right,
well,
look at Tommy.
Whatever that noise has got to
stop. Suddenly a Twitter baby.
Yeah, Pete, you better stop breathing into the phone or you're getting disconnected.
I think it's because, I think it's this heater that I'm sitting by. That's got to be
then
what it
turn
is.
Turn it the fuck off.
Yeah, no, I'm moving.
Seriously.
He's got the chills. He's drunk. Yeah, he hasn't had enough liquor. He's got the alcohol withdrawal.
He's got the DTs.
Oh.
Exactly.
Yo, so what's, honestly, I wanted to bring this up. I wanted to bring this up before. What's Rousey saying? She's going to continue her media blackout prior to 207. Didn't Conor get taken off of the 200 card for the same reasons? Like, why? Like,
no
one's heard from her. She tweets out two pictures.
Here.
No.
Look, Conor didn't
Please.
Do the 200 card because he wanted
oh
to get paid
God.
More money and not do media.
He didn't want to do media. Thank
no,
you. He didn't want to do the media.
For two
once
reasons.
Once again, Tommy's got his facts misinterpreted with Conor.
No. He said
got
he
him.
Didn't want to do the press conference. So they pulled him from
the
car.
And he didn't want more, and he wanted more money.
And
dude, he was in Iceland training with his fucking, training with a new team.
Conor got everything, every cent he's ever asked for.
He was training
yeah,
with Gunnar.
He was in, yeah, he was in Iceland or something, training with a whole team of people, and he didn't want to bring them over for
Gunnar
the
never
he's like,
the Viking.
You have to,
he was doing,
you guys
Viking
have to understand
shit.
Something. You have to understand something, which is badass. You have to understand something. When Conor was fighting Aldo and going around the freaking world for this media tour, although, you know, the first fight he pulled out or whatever, and then it went again. Like, he had to take two takes of every interview, one where he was assumed to fight Aldo and the next one where he's assumed to fight Chad. He literally was asked
the
same questions.
The Rousey Cup question?
No, but it's compared because Conor got taken off the card for the same stuff. So
yeah,
why
no,
is Rousey
taken off the card? No, Rousey's not no-showing media. She just isn't giving any interviews that does, she's not required to do.
Okay, so if that's clarification, then that's fine. I just wanted to bring
yeah.
it up because
she's
I didn't
like
understand.
She's like going to do a press conference. In fact, Nunes was the one that no-showed the recent press conference due to a medical issue. Rousey was there.
But that's different. I mean, medical's fine, but, you know.
Yeah, but
I think these press conferences are a little stupid. Would you hear
medical?
Massive amounts of them?
Yeah,
you know,
there's too much.
Massive
I
amounts of press
no.
conference? That's stupid.
No,
you're
there's a massive amount of press conferences because there's a massive amount of fucking UFC cards. But there's the same. You have to have a pre-fight press conference to, like, you know,
have. Yeah, but you don't need to have okay. multiple press conferences.
I don't know that there is though, dude. Like,
Chris,
no,
I think he's right though,
on.
Dude.
Multiple.
I kind of noticed that. Like, yeah, we worry about the running the risk of oversaturation at that point.
Fight,
you know,
they have one press conference. When there's a huge thing where, like, they do, like, the time is now and they have a huge announcement, they might have another one where they ask fighters to fly out for no specific reason, like they had them all on that panel that day, you know, announcing like six different cards. That
the
I
Go
guess.
Big panel. Yeah. All right,
yeah, but think about what we just said about when McGregor and Aldo went all over the place.
Yeah, but
doing
that was the world tour
for their
like
first
the
fight.
Fucking, that was the world tour for that. For that. Like,
I understand,
the biggest fight in
but
history.
That's stupid. It's stupid.
Oh my god.
You're
well,
taking
when you
away,
have,
you're
when
taking
you're fighting
away from training. You're taking
I
away
agree.
From these guys training. That's what they need to be doing.
Yeah, but
they don't
so, whoa. So, Tommy, you agree with Conor for what he was saying by why he didn't want to come to the press conference then, right?
Oh,
is that what you're telling me?
That I agree with.
You love it, right, Omar? You see how I
don't
like
agree with anybody. Yeah, but I would agree with anybody for saying that.
I think
that
the press conference is dumb.
That just happened, guys.
What the hell?
Well, I can't believe it just happened, Buzzer. Tommy agrees with Conor McGregor.
I
fell out of my chair.
Oh my you know how much content and quotes we have gotten from these press conferences? You know, like, they're so essential to what we're doing right now.
It builds the product.
Why not do it,
it builds
the product.
Why not
do it over the phone?
It builds
it does.
The product.
It does build it.
They get it over the phone with GFC
room
and Nick Diaz.
Happen. You put these guys in the same building and things pop off and happen. And this is where we get our fucking our kicks from, man. Like, this is it. I love
this. This is what sells pay-per-views.
Yeah.
It sells,
you know,
pay-per-views.
Like,
this is what got the price to be 4.4.
They know what they're doing. They're oversaturating because there's so many UFC cards. But each card, they have one press conference per card. That's it.
Yeah.
I think there definitely is more.
I think it would be better if they just did it over the phone. Like I said, they did it with
Nick
Diaz and GSP.
Call, the media conference call. They do that.
That's all it should be.
But this
so
is
not
fight
the same.
The
yeah, but here's the difference. Here's what we're forgetting the fact that, you know, ESPN is a separate entity from UFC. So if they want to have an interview with these guys, it's not a UFC sanctioned
or scheduled.
It's not a press
conference. UFC holds one required press conference. These other things that these guys are doing, interview-wise, that's just other shit. That's interview.
Which fighters kind of group together in, you know, the same grouping. Oh, we got to do all these interviews, all this media bullshit.
Yeah, you know, it's press conferences for the UFC. There's one, fight week.
But you
that's
can't
it.
Chew your nose off to spite
I would
your
kill
face
to have that problem, guys.
That's what I'm saying.
I would
you,
kill to
don't
have
you
that
want
problem.
To be well-known? That gets you
I want
out
people
there.
Calling
that's
me. I want people
get
calling me.
To say something and be on, you know, get your face out there.
Exactly.
And these guys are bitching about it.
Yes.
And then
I
can have a career after fighting because I got notorious. I got known during the fight game. I, you know what? One of the things that I'll never understand, and this is, you know, my time on a soapbox is what are you bitching about? All right. part of, you know, you want to go get punched in the face for 15 minutes. I get it. I love the sport. But do you want to make it make you as much money as possible? Then you're going to have to get in front of a camera. You're going to have to give some witty one-liners. Have somebody write them for you if you suck at them. I don't care.
Somebody needs to write Cody Garbrandt's fucking shit talking down for him because he was so mad.
They were both pretty bad.
He can't.
I never
He goes to the Ken Shamrock School of shit talking. That's where he went. He went to the Ken Shamrock School.
Me and Pete were actually talking about that. I think it was right after they did that little interview where, like, what was he saying, Pete, about how he never chased?
I never chased pussy my whole life. I'm not gonna when he fights Cruz. I guess he's saying because Donald was just like, you're not gonna be able to catch me, and I'm too hard to hit.
Right.
Blah blah.
What do you think the outcome of that fight, Pete? Like, where do you see Cody taking Cruz out?
I don't know. I really don't. I see Cruz taking the win, but there is always, like, the puncher's chance, man.
I think Cody's style.
I don't like him as a dude. I think he sounds he's just like somebody I wouldn't like, I don't think.
Yeah, he tried to call McGregor out that day. I get it, he's sticking up for Dillashaw, but, dude, you're sticking up for the wrong guy for the wrong reasons.
He just seems like a douche to me, but I don't know him. I'd probably fucking be on his fucking,
If you follow him on social media, you might get a different perspective.
The two of you are part of that strong hairline club. You got to give him that. The two of you, your heads are hair.
Let's
be honest. Some things, those are some locks, bro. Those are some
It's pretty amazing
locks,
how me and my brother, neither me and my brother lost our hair yet. And one of us should. I thought he was going to be the one to lose it, but he's hanging on. I got to give him credit.
That's terrible. Don't put that on him, Ricky Bobby. Don't you dare put that negativity on him.
Hey, he's got a nice head of hair. I got to give it to him. He does have it. I thought he lost it by now.
Yeah, but I think Dom is going to make him look really, really bad. I think he's going to school him.
Yeah, I think it's going to be pretty bad.
Cody was saying, he's like, I went from unranked to world champion in one calendar year. Well, I think that you might have just bit off more than you could chew because of the lack of a contender.
Jumped
in
the
division.
It's such a weird fight because everybody automatically wants to go right for Cruz, just like we all did with Mighty Mouse. Look what almost happened to Mighty Mouse. You know what I mean?
Yeah, but almost didn't even
Mighty
hear
Mouse. Whitey Mouse? You're about to say Whitey Mouse.
I said Mighty Mouse.
Whitey Mouse!
almost happened, but it really wasn't really that close. I don't think that Mighty Mouse was ever really at risk.
Well, he lost a round, didn't he? I mean, there was...
Dude, he almost
got
taken out in that first round.
No, he didn't. I mean, like, he
I agree.
Almost,
I think he did, Chris. I really think he was
closer
than you think.
He was never... It was close. But, like, as close as it was, there was never a point where it was actually like, wow, he might tap.
Did anybody else in that division put it on him like that, though?
No, not at all. But
I don't think he really
got it put on him. He fucking, he almost submitted him with a fucking choke, and then he got out of it. And he got it put on him.
He there was two chokes that were relatively closer than I've ever seen anybody put my choke.
Yeah, of course.
That's the scary thing with Cody and Dominic. I mean...
I don't think Cody has a chance to grapple with him, though.
I don't think so either.
I agree with that.
Cody's got dynamite in those hands.
I don't know how good
Cruz's chin is. You know what I mean?
We got time for that fight. We don't have to worry about that yet.
Cruz is very hard to hit, man, clean. I've never really seen him get caught with much clean shit.
No, but that's
a good fighter. His movement is good. And that brings up what we talk about all the time. The movement in MMA is a thing.
This could be a lot like the Weidman Silva one, though. I could see it possibly happening where the changing of guard, happens because Dom has been around for a while. He's had some fucking tough injuries to come back from. I just don't know about it.
He doesn't have the miles on him. I don't think he has as many. I mean, the injuries are the injuries.
He doesn't have the mileage. That's true.
He doesn't have the mileage because he's always
Guys, hurt. We got time. We can talk about this fight when the fight gets a little closer. I want to save some banter for that time.
You're the one who brought it up.
Dude, what are you talking about? let's touch on other things that have happened, like the fight that happened this weekend. Like, we could talk about what's next for Mickey Gall. That's a little more relevant because that
just
happened.
I was just going to say, how do you guys like Mickey Gall calling out fucking Dan Hardy?
Mickey Gall's got
I think it's smart.
Fucking call outs, man.
That's what I'm saying.
No,
Tommy, you think he's smart. I get it. He's going after
How are we talking about the right thing, Cody Glass?
Because this just happened. He's calling out the wrong guys, I think. I mean, I don't know. I get it. Tommy said in our group chat, he was like, he's moving up the ranks. He's calling out guys that are, you know, somewhat at his level so he can beat these guys
in weight classes, guys that don't belong in, that aren't professional fighters. And then he calls out a guy that's a lightweight, and now he's calling out a guy that's retired for fucking 5 years because of, like, an enlarged heart.
He wants to move down to lightweight, though, I think, is the last I've heard. He wants to make that move towards that division.
He's
exactly.
I don't know if he can make that weight, man. He's a bigger welterweight.
He looks like a big dude, yeah. He looks like a big guy. I don't know.
He's 55. It's his weight class.
He's not a bigger welterweight. He's just a big dude.
He's 6 foot two. He would look like a skeleton at 155. He looked bad. I mean, I don't know how that would work out, but
you can't hate on him for wanting to call out Hardy. Hardy said he wants to fight again. Okay, so he's been out of the game for a little while, and Ball is relatively new. That's a pretty.
Well, he's
good
going
after
for Hardy. He's kind of going after like
Hardy
gimmicky guys.
Anybody.
Yeah,
I don't want Hardy
fighting
anybody
either.
Dude, I'd call out a guy like Neil Magny or someone like in the top 10 in your weight.
Absolutely.
He's not ready for that.
Punch in the chest and die.
It doesn't
bullshit.
Matter. If he's not ready for that, he's not ready for Dan Hardy either then.
I agree.
Well,
yeah,
Dan Hardy's been out of the game
Hardy?
For a while.
Yeah, Dan Hardy's right, Hardy. Of course. He's like it's like calling me out. What's the difference? That means nothing. I mean, I understand.
Right, how about this, Matt Brown?
Wait, hold on.
You know,
hold on a second.
Eric.
Yeah, Omar? I'm just saying, calling out somebody who's not even relevant to what's going on right now. I mean, that's my point.
Take a step up in competition. Call out a guy in the top 15 in your
way. Hey, Dan Hardy might die in the ring.
I love you. I love you, Carl, but what just happened right now?
If you're unranked, if you're Mickey Gall and you're unranked, you need to call out someone in your weight class that's ranked ahead of you.
I think that's correct.
What, is it 3-0? Hold on. It's 4-0. Are you forgetting? The man's 3-4. Okay, 4-0.
He fought CM Punk's old ass. I mean, Sage Northcutt, I mean, I get it. He's muscular and he had some hype surrounding him, but... You know, what's been happening with this guy? I mean, is he – I think he might be letting the success get to him.
He's in the UFC now, so he's in the UFC. He should be calling out guys that are ranked higher than him in his weight class.
Yeah, but you can't give him a top 10 guy at 4-0.
I didn't say a top 10 guy.
Yes, you did. You said he should
be calling
out guys
that are ranked
top 10.
I said he should call out – was Matt Brown in the top 10 still?
You said Neil Magny.
I said him first, and then I was like, yeah, you guys said, no, that's too much. I said, all right, fine. Then how about like a Matt Brown, Eric Silva type?
I don't think that's how it went, but still, I mean, you can call out the number one fighter and not get him. I get that. Hey, you're in the ring. You're in the octagon post-fight interview. You're trying to hype yourself at that point. Give me the friggin' champion.
That's what I want next.
Like,
if he calls out, just because I would call out a guy that's in the top 10 or a top 15 fighter,
yeah,
whether he's going to get it or not is irrelevant. Who should he call out is what was said, not who should he fight.
Mickey Gall versus Takanori Gomi. I want to see him fight people that are on his level, regardless of rankings, honestly, because you know what? I think – if he's given the proper time to mature as a fighter, I'm excited to see where he goes. I don't want to see him get thrown in with a savage that's going to kick his dick in, and then we'll never hear from Mickey Gall again. He'll be a shell of what he was.
Yeah, I mean,
I'm sorry.
Look, he's doing it. He's doing it the right way. Okay,
so
yeah. His first fight.
Who would you think is a good matchup for Mickey Gall then? Right now, that begs the question.
Asking us on the spot. It's too tough.
No, I'm just saying, not like a type, not a specific fighter, but like where? Like you could give me a range of guys. Like,
Japan.
What do you think?
Get him to fight. Get him on a Japan card and have him fight a local talent. Like have him be one of those guys that okay, listen, you're not gonna fight a really really ranked guy, but you're gonna go into another country and fight one of the local heroes that you put on
like
the show.
I like that, Omar.
Right?
Ben Saunders or Court McGee where?
That'd be fine.
You know
that'd
what?
Be,
that's
that would,
not,
that's yeah.
actually not a bad idea.
But you know what
that's
it does, Omar? It kind of makes you the villain. You go in there as the severe underdog. Like, yeah, you might not be fighting a huge guy, but you get to see this guy's metal at that time. You know, you're going into enemy territory if you come out a win.
Right.
I think that vaulted him up.
That's the fight game. Everybody's got to go into enemy territory at some point in their career. There's nothing wrong
with
that.
But what he's saying is if you do that against maybe a lesser-ranked opponent,
Sorry.
It kind of should.
I'm not.
I kind of think it proves a little more to who you are, you know, what your heart is. And, you know, you go in there and everyone's bullying you. Some people feed off that.
Like maybe that has more of an effect on the guys during fight week. But when it's actually the fight, I don't think that matters.
I do. You know, during the fight, they're calling, you know, like, chanting for the other dude. It's like, damn, everyone's against me.
If I think somebody's
really going to
stab my girlfriend,
letting that affect
crowd,
you, then you're in the wrong fucking
fighting,
sport.
I'm worried. All right?
What'd
if
you
I
say,
think
Omar?
Somebody's going to try to behead... If I think somebody's going to try to behead, like, my family or my girl in the crowd that I brought to come see me fight,
I wouldn't be there.
I'm telling you.
So we're talking about Mickey Gall. We're talking a lot about Mickey Gall. What's up with Sage, though? Like, where do we think he's going to go from here? I mean,
he's got to go back down the line.
Should ask for the Barbarina rematch.
Mean Cage?
Get a win back under his belt. And, you know,
he seems smaller than Conor to me.
Nah, he doesn't need to fight Barbarina, dude, because he's what, 3-0 at lightweight. He only lost the two times that he fought at welterweight. So
I'm very surprised that he's even fighting at 70. And he doesn't look bigger than Conor.
You know
I get
what?
It, he's bulky, he's
I
a small dude.
Hair product.
Northcutt
hair product
is
what gets him to 170.
Tommy hates Sage Northcutt, bro.
Talk about
what do you guys think?
Dude, he's 20 years old, bro. He's 3-0 at lightweight.
Talk about
he's 20 years old.
And he's been fighting. And how long has he been fighting in the UFC? A year? A year?
I don't know. He's got five fights.
Zero ground skills.
3 years.
So these losses.
2 years. Zero ground skills. Zero.
These losses.
Zero.
You're
got time to learn.
Hating on this cat too. He's got ground skills, dude.
Yeah. Well, that submission he fought out of that. What was it?
Clearly got to work on some things, but you know he's got a lot of time.
Work on some things.
Did you see the picture of him hanging out with the Diaz brothers backstage, Chris?
Yeah.
He should be solely working on wrestling and jiu-jitsu. He already has the kickboxing.
Isn't he training with Woodley that racist?
Can I ask you something, Tommy? You don't think that's what he's doing? Like, this guy's definitely a quick study. He's gonna improve greatly on the ground. We know that because he's a freak.
He only has to go up from here. All right, he can't go anywhere but up.
Exactly,
on the
he's
ground.
Too young to.
Yeah, you know,
right, how low can he go?
Well, he was an idiot. He was an idiot for leaving Farasahabi and TriStar, and I'm so glad Mickey Gall picked up on that. Because you don't get better than Farasahabi. You don't get any better than that guy.
Yeah,
he knows what he's doing.
I know he was working with Woodley for the Wonder Boy fight.
But he still is.
He's a token white
guy.
They say the token white guy.
The word is that.
Right?
Token white guy. I like it.
The word is that his dad pulled him out of TriStar. His dad's like really bad for his career, and he needs to get away from him type of deal. That's what
of course
his dad
really
is
bad.
White
the juicer.
Joe Jackson
He should start training under Carly
Watson. He's Joe Jackson of MMA. That's Sage Northcutt's dad right there. He's
should start training underneath Charlie Weidman.
Don't
take cheap shots like that, dude. That's wrong.
Oh.
Don't take cheap shots
like
that.
Was that a cheap shot? I don't know. I didn't take it as a cheap shot. Can we just take a second to, you know, maybe congratulate or give a fair send-off to Uriah Vamber? At least he won the fight, went out in style. A career that was mainly front-loaded, let's be honest, in the WEC years.
I wouldn't say
has
that.
Not completely.
That the bar so high for himself that anything less than a world championship was, like, looked at as, like, you know, he's underachieving. But the fact
it was front-loaded in my eyes.
But he won a lot of fights late in his career. You know, he fought Edgar, tough fight. You know, like, he just beat Brad Pickett. He's beaten, you know, a lot of these guys.
Oh,
that,
you
like,
mean front-loaded?
Right. Oh, so you mean his career is front-loaded, basically?
I mean,
you know what, dude? He looked the best I've seen him look in a long time.
Really? He did. I agree with that.
Yo,
that
I think he's 3-2 in the past five, so that's not terrible.
And the two that he lost was
Dom and Edgar. You know, it's not like he's losing the bad guys. He fights the best.
Yeah.
He's the hot lady at the wedding that always catches the garter but never gets married.
Yeah.
That's who
always the bridesmaid.
And I respect why he retired. He said, like, how many shots could I get? You know what I mean? Like, you know, like, he's got a bunch of guys that are younger than him and that he's training with in his gym that, like, you know, come on.
Charlie Brown.
You know, he's taking opportunity away from people at this point.
Well, you know,
always
I mean, whatever.
Football. Yanks it right out from under him.
Yo, but yo, did anybody see the news of like a Lawler Diaz 2?
I was just you son of a bitch.
I did see that.
Nice segue. I was gonna bring up what's next for the
shoulder, Carl.
He's looking through the wall here, so I'm not even in the same room. But that was a good one. Right. Yeah, who does Nick Diaz get when he comes back? I mean, I can get excited for a Lawler fight.
It should be a no-brainer. They're both fucking need a you know, neither guy's got an opponent.
Excuse me.
Three-way match.
I can't hate that. I mean, it's either Lawler, GSP, Bisping, or who else? I mean, who else could it be? It's not going to be Bisping, obviously.
It's not Bisping. It's not GSP because GSP isn't even fucking signed. Like, until GSP is back, I don't want to hear any GSP fight talk.
Well, I'm just based off what I know.
We will talk about Nick Diaz. What the fuck?
Nick Diaz ain't signed either.
Not even UFC. Nick Diaz is like signed, ready to fight, waiting for a fight.
First of all, GSP is signed. I don't think Nick Diaz has a current contract.
GSP is signed, dude. Chris, that's the problem. GSP is signed.
No, GSP had a contract, but he's not contracted right now.
He's got a contract
like
right
an
SBA. It's frozen.
I don't get
what get a fight.
What Nick Diaz and GSP have to do with each other in this situation? I said, like, we're
talking. No, it's just funny that you're like, we could talk about Nick Diaz, but let's not talk about GSP, but they're, like, both in the same boat right now.
No, they're not, dude. How do you figure that?
Theoretically, Chris,
Nick
don't
Diaz
take it.
And now
don't take it literal, dude.
They're
don't
in limbo. They're both in fighting purgatory. Can we just leave it at
right.
that? How about
they,
that?
They are. Right.
Thank in limbo.
Their situations aren't exactly the same.
George St. Pierre doesn't.
I'll give you that.
You're going to see Nick Diaz.
Who does Nick Diaz want to fight, bro? He's been offered a couple of fights already, and I haven't heard anything from him.
The Lawler fight would be cool just because Lawler's gotten so much better since the first time they fought.
I would love to see the Lawler fight, yeah, but
and
he's
also,
not really saying anything.
Answer your question, Pete, like why talk about, like the whole topic was Nick Diaz. Like we said,
I know, I'm just good, relax. I'm just, I don't want to hear any GSP talk.
No, I just don't think we should be mentioning him as a possible opponent because he's not really even... You know,
I mentioned
like,
him because
White
the media is mentioning
him. GSP's not fighting. He was like rolling in the Bellator cage the other day with Chael Sonnen.
I didn't make that up, though. You know, there's been talks of it. That's the only reason why I brought it up. But can we just talk about a second? Like, how misunderstood that, like, these Diaz brothers actually are? The more I mean, I've always been a fan of Nick Diaz. Nick Diaz bothered me. He was too, like, corny. Like, he, you know, walking around, like, flexing his back
muscles. He had a thing against
like,
his lisp.
It had nothing to do with it. No, absolutely not. It had more to do with the, you know, his brain and how like dumb he seemed and how he tried to like seem like, oh, I'm a thug, this and that. He like walks around like flexing his back, you know, with that like tall, lanky gazelle body that Conor said. But you know, that has nothing to do with it. I actually like Nate Diaz now, but I've always been a fan of Nick Diaz. He's always been so misunderstood as to. You know, he held that, like, heel role before it was, like, popular to be a heel in the UFC. And I think his career suffered because of that. Fans didn't like him. He never got the money fight.
Yeah, yo,
he never got a decision.
He doesn't know how to express himself verbally. And then when he sounds like an asshole and he knows he lashes out. And like,
well,
that's
these
just...
Diaz brothers, this is what happens with the Diaz brothers. My bad for cutting you off. This is what happens with the Diaz brothers, I think. Their brains... are going faster than their words can get out. So in like the middle of his thought, he'll be like, yeah, he like agrees with his thought in his head out loud to the media. He'll be talking about like the Conor fight, smoking weed, a CBD pen in the post fight interview. And then he'll be like going around like, oh, that jiu-jitsu guy for Conor, I'm going to get that motherfucker. Meanwhile, he's smoking weed and bouncing all over Island Ronnie. I thought you were fired. You know, it's like, these guys can't stay on a thought and get it out quick enough before their next thought.
I think it's a social anxiety thing, you know, like that's just.
I'm not ready to diagnose anybody, but, you know, it's kind of something. I don't think it's social
anxiety.
Nick is diagnosed with that, social anxiety disorder. That's a fact.
I did not know that. Well, if that's the case, then that's fine. I feel less uncomfortable talking about
it. That came up when he was in court for, I think the pot thing.
Yeah.
Pot gives you more anxiety. Why would you use that as an excuse?
Pot gives
allegedly.
Some people anxiety, and some people it takes it away. It
I mean, I was told. I don't know.
It depends how you fucking react. You know, like everybody's different, man.
Right.
You know, weed calms me down unless I'm in a situation where I shouldn't be high. You know, like.
Like driving,
right.
You mean?
you mean like the 202 post fight press conference where you're sitting there smoking,
like talking to cops?
Yeah,
yeah,
it's like oh, it's the CBD oil. And
this
then,
is true
was
CBD.
Like, that was straight Kush. He was like, he just had his post fight piss test. We were in the press conference. They don't let you do the press conference until you piss. He was like, so my brother was definitely getting high. No question about it.
Which
well,
I
I'll
love.
Tell you what made Nick Diaz look like the biggest asshole was that phone conversation, the interview he did with GSP. He just sounded like a complete and utter moron all those years ago. I don't know if you guys listened to that. That was so bad.
I don't remember
it
that.
It was so bad. I mean, he sounded so stupid. He sounded
I'm not
so
hardcore
stupid.
Though.
I don't think that he sounded stupid at all, dude. Like, I listened to that, and he's just fucking...
Of course not.
I really don't, dude. Like, he was fucking... Like I said, he doesn't know how to talk. He doesn't know how to articulate himself.
Was your brother switched at birth? Is he really a Diaz? Is he like just a Canelo Alvarez? Is he a redheaded Mexican?
Well, here, I'll tell you one of the dumb
things
that
he said. Conor McGregor, you know, like, what the fuck?
I'll tell you one of the dumb things that he said. They asked him why
yes,
he doesn't.
I wish.
They asked him why he never wants to go to the press conferences, and his reasoning was, well, I don't have somebody to set things up for me like George does. I have to do everything for myself.
Which you might be right, though.
Question. How did that answer the question?
Well, that's the thing. Nick Diaz from day one, he'll get interviewed, and Chris kind of, I got to give him credit because he kind of brought this up to me, and I've been paying attention to it ever since. He has an agenda and has something that he wants to get out and said, he doesn't care what the question is. The question will be like, well, how do you think of your opponent? He'll be like, yeah, well, you know, I've been training with this guy. He's an up-and-coming. Like, he gets out what he wants to get out when the question's asked. It's irrelevant what the question is. He wants to speak on what he wants to speak on. So I think that all led – it compounds over time and leads to what we talked about
up
front.
You know how you get an assistant to do things for you? When you consistently fight and then you win belts and you consistently defend
Nick Diaz says, you ask me a stupid question, you're going to get a stupid answer. I don't think that he really put much thought into that. And, like, he doesn't really even believe that. I guarantee it. You know, like, he just doesn't care. He said the first thing that popped into his head. And, like, he just doesn't give a shit what you're trying to break it down as. You know, I don't think that he even remembers fucking saying that dumb shit.
So what
and
are you saying? Nick Diaz's brain is like Common Core math. It just makes no sense.
Yes.
Is that what you're saying?
Oh, wow.
That's
yeah, but then listen to like the interview on Opie and Anthony and tell me that he's not a fucking likable guy. Like, you know what I mean? Like, you listen to him when he's cutting weight fight week or when he's fucking talking to a guy that he's about to fight and you're going to get a different Nick Diaz. He admits that. You know what I mean? Like, this is...
Well, because when he's on Opie and Anthony, he's probably higher than shit.
Okay.
So he can be friendly.
Higher than evil.
Don't sit here and knock people who smoke weed. Half the fucking country smokes weed. You know, like...
You're really saying I'm not...
Where are your numbers?
Do that?
It has nothing to do... with the weed.
But I'm making a point. You know what I mean? Like, he's not... You got two different versions of the guy, you know, like there's the fight guy and then there's the fucking regular guy. Like he puts on a front.
Well,
everybody knows that.
I want the real Diaz and I want him sober. I don't want him high off that lettuce.
Putting on a front is the wrong word. I think that he's just, that's who he becomes when it's fight mode.
Sure, I give you that. That's fair. I get it. But I can't hate a guy. It's the fight game. I can't. I remember looking back when Kimbo fought Seth Petruzzelli. He was interviewed by this girl right before he went out.
Yeah,
right,
you right, loved the Seth Petruzzelli fight.
Yeah,
I mean,
think
the guy
that you brought this
shit.
Up is exactly.
Oh my god.
I made three people hundreds of dollars on that fight. I don't want to hear it because I'm such a hardcore fan.
Yo, but I'm pretty sure you've said this exact thing on this podcast before. Like,
no,
before.
I'm just saying
it almost every week. Almost every week.
Dude,
he
told the girl off. He basically, like, talked this woman off right before he went out.
Fight, fucking
yeah.
He
was, like, in her face. But I can't hate him because he's going out to fight. I mean, what do you
– Hey, guys, did you hear that that Cyborg got busted for PEDs? Yeah, back when Seth Petruzzelli fought Kimbo. Who gives a shit?
I hate Conor for not defending his belt, but Aldo can do it. It's cool. I'm only a Conor hater because McGiblets.
You know, Seth Petruzzelli fought Kimbo, nobody was defending him.
Yo, that's a low blow. Don't low blow, bro. Low blow, bro. That's my boy.
all y'all can fist yourselves. Oh man, so have we got any fights coming up this weekend?
I know
John Jones, I think he's signed on. I don't know if he's signed on yet, but there is talks about him in a grappling only match against Frank Mir. What do you guys think of that?
Frank Mir?
I don't think much of it. What about this joking.
What?
That's terrible. This guy.
Yeah,
you
should
like
this.
Who is John Jones grappling next? Because first it was supposed to be Chael. Then I heard Luke Rockhold. Then I heard Frank Mir.
I heard Gary.
And then I saw Conor McGregor's training partner. What's his name? Dylan Dennis.
Yeah. I don't think it's going to be anybody that's contracted under the UFC right now.
No, definitely not.
You know,
definitely
I don't think it's going to be anybody that's actually contracted. But
I think
Frank Mir and John Jones, that would be interesting.
Why not? Why don't you think that?
Because it's in their contract. They're not allowed to do anything extra.
Yeah, it's like an NFL player going to play like a pickup game. You know,
I remember McGregor was doing grappling.
I just do it. She's under the contract.
Not well.
Yeah, I remember. I remember McGregor was doing grappling events too when he was under contract.
I think you're allowed no contact grappling.
Right.
I'm not sure. I'm not sure.
I don't know what you guys are talking about.
Because that was one of the stipulations when Fedor wanted to come in the UFC all those years ago. He wanted to do the Sambo
tournament.
Speaking of Fedor, when Kimbo fought Seth Petruzzelli, oh Jesus! Yo, do you guys think that Alan Jouban deserves a top 15 rank? Real quick, I'll ask you this. I kind of do too. I think he's a fight away from being the top 10.
Mickey Gall, Alan Jouban.
Not yet.
Ooh. But that's more of a guy that would get the creative juices flowing for the fans. Like, you call Alan Jouban out in the cage, the fans are going to immediately clamor about that fight. That's what you got to do.
That's a good fight. If you want to call out a guy that's got a little different, like, a little side deal going on, a little media behind him, Alan Jouban definitely has something going on with, like, the Armani deal.
Got that Gucci.
I love that he beat what's his name's ass this weekend. Who did Jouban fight?
Mike Perry.
Yeah.
Clown.
Well, what about Alan Jouban versus Seth Petruzzelli? What do you guys think of that?
Yo, I have a good
I think the winner should get Kimbo.
No,
the winner should fight Kimbo.
Mickey Gall, you know?
Oh,
I thought that fucking crazy Viking and knocked out
Paul
Harris.
Let him rest,
Chris, what are you saying?
He's got the same heart condition that Dan Hardy had, all right? We can't be bringing Dan Hardy back.
That's why Hardy should not fight.
No,
exactly.
Leave him alone. That crazy Viking dude that fucking knocked out Paul Harris.
The Mel Mack, he's a maniac.
Oh, Emil?
I mean,
he was
interviewed by, it's spelled Meek, but it says Meck. He was interviewed by Megan O'Leary in the post-fight in the locker room, and he was, like, flexing to her, like, looking her up and down.
He's a
like,
lunatic, but he's a,
bro,
straight,
he's a
yo,
maniac.
I've known him a little bit on social media. Yo, this dude's a fucking interesting guy, man. He's nuts.
Well, absolutely. Emil
he's
Meck,
a funny guy.
E-M-I-L-M-E-E-K.
And I definitely think he's got some promise, man. He's definitely got some promise.
The UFC made him shave his, like, trademark beard because they said
he
was too long
or
something.
Guy,
Canada
never,
did.
Yeah.
Yeah.
No, but, like, I don't
Canada
know if they would
did.
Have
oh.
him and Gall fight because
Canada,
they're going
right.
to derail one of them. I think that they definitely want to build both of these guys up.
I don't think you put too much in that, dude, where they're going to derail. You said that about Khabib Ferguson. Like, I don't believe that. They're young enough. Let them fight now. This way the loser can build himself back up.
Yeah.
You don't want it going on
well,
too
I'm
long.
Just saying, like, I don't agree with that. I think that the UFC does that too a lot. They don't want to match certain
guys younger,
later in their career.
Yeah,
you know,
a younger fighter would get derailed faster. Like, Khabib Ferguson, the loser, that's not going to get derailed. You know,
yeah,
like, they both
like,
have, like...
But, you know, I didn't agree with the Almeida-Cody fight this early. Like, they were 10-9. You know, they should have fought later in their career. Because it derails Almeida, and now he's got to fight all the way back. You know, like, I think it made no sense. Like, you want to build
these
guys
up. Say you're the 10th ranked opponent fighter, and you're fighting the 9th ranked fighter, and the 9th ranked fighter wins. Like, why should the 10th ranked fighter drop so much? Like, I don't think he drops that much. Maybe
I don't know
one
that he
spot.
Drops so much, but if a guy below him is coming off of a win, then, you know, like, you got to kind of honor that.
Yeah, man, it depends.
You shouldn't
how.
Drop
like,
a guy five
horrible.
Spots.
No, I'm not saying nobody should.
Yeah,
drop
it depends how, right? Honestly, I really do think it depends how. If the guy gets a shit tart kicked
yeah,
out of him,
you know,
then,
you get
yeah.
caught with a punch that you were winning the fight, maybe not. You don't move at all.
Whatever.
I don't know.
I mean,
I just think that we're talking about possible matchups for Gall, and it's been going through my head since. Like, what interesting, you know, welterweight.
what's his name? Was I was
yeah,
reading
today
that. Yeah,
but he's dropping to 55. He wants to drop to 55, so you got
to
start
that
looking
at him. Until he drops to 55 and makes the weight, I don't believe he could.
I don't even want to see that.
He's 6'2", dude. He's a bigger guy.
That doesn't mean shit. Ben Saunders is like 6'5". He was dropping that. Like,
yeah, I know.
Yeah, Ben Henderson
was,
you
was can't
what,
make lightweight,
6'3", 6'4"?
But Mickey Gall is fucking gonna, you know? Like,
dude, I'm enormous. Are you kidding me? I'm absolutely enormous. Whoa. I'm dropping down to 55.
I don't want to hear about this, Carl. Carl, calm down. It's a good show.
Sure it is.
I was reading today that Kevin Lee was trying to call out Mickey Gall. You know,
I'm
Kevin
calling
Lee.
Out Mickey
Gall. Yeah,
I'm calling out Mickey Gall for being a douche and calling out the wrong people. I'm calling him
Jesus
out.
Christ.
You can't fight.
He's not a lady at a bar, Carl. You can't punch him in the head and then flex on everybody.
How are we looking on time?
We're
coming down to that wire. Chris.
Yeah, we're getting here. We're basically at it. I was going to just pose a quick question. Is there any fights this weekend? I know there's fights on the New Year's weekend, the WSOS fight. And I'm sure.
How about
UFC
in Tommy's parking lot? Is there anything coming up this weekend?
There's no fights in my last night here, thank God.
I guess. Okay.
Tommy, you're coming back. Yes. You're coming back to Jersey? Or you're going back to Virginia.
I'm only going to be in Jersey until January 2nd, and then I'll be back in Virginia.
Thank God.
That sucks.
You're right. Thank God, because I love money.
Such a bastard.
Good for you.
Lord.
Right? What a
that
prick
was
this guy
the grindiest is. Thing I've heard somebody say.
Dude, oh. So fucked up. But I guess this is definitely where we're cutting it off before we go too far off the rails where we cause like what was that movie with Will Smith where he like stopped the train and caused like a friggin' a Hancock where he caused like a huge friggin' accident. He tried to save one person, wound up killing like 500 people instead. I don't know, whatever. It was a good movie.
You look at movies when you're on dates, Carl? Jesus, that's where you're doing it wrong, bro. I don't believe
we're
that.
Getting close
I
to that.
Spencer Zelli was in that movie, to be
no,
honest.
No, we just did it. We just went off the rails with this whole fucking Hancock explanation.
Oh, all y'all can kiss my Hancock. Anyway.
That Kimbo Slice movie, Hancock.
Carl Gucci movie, Hancock. Anyway, we're stopping it right here. Guys, it was definitely a good, interesting discussion we had today. I'm glad we got to roast Tommy. I noticed Tommy said Omar was taking his back, but I don't remember Omar really kind of siding with Tommy during that argument. So I really think
taking
that Tommy was just looking for
a... Are we grappling here? I don't want none of Tommy after what I heard, all right, today. I'm going to leave it at that. All right, to protect the industry.
Tommy's choking people out just for living at this point. Jesus.
Honestly.
Well,
the guy tried to buy him a cup of coffee, and then he gets the choke of death on him. He's like, listen, I'm doing my job. I'm choking
Tommy's
you out.
Like
I'm taking your cab.
The cops came and had to pry my hands from around his throat. Tommy said, "Oh, I love it." Meanwhile,
and just
guy,
so you
know,
being a white man in America lets you get away with, fellas. All right, if Tyron Woodley had done that,
God, don't even bring
if that ain't white privilege.
No, we should agree to not ever bring up the race card again.
Yo,
I'm not scared of that. I'm clearly
not
really
in my back pocket.
It's not like
right?
we shouldn't really be talking about it. We don't fucking experience that.
I don't like that he pulls it. I'm going to talk about it. I'm hiding nothing.
You're telling me as a redheaded ginger, you don't get racially profiled? Get the hell out
expect
of here, bro.
Expect the call from Jesse Jackson next week, boys.
Just to clarify, Chris does not have red hair. His beard might be red a little bit, but he does not have red hair. I don't know about this whole
ginger.
I have my beard
in my pubes.
Okay.
Well, if you're showing those
who the hell,
in that order,
it's 2016.
Anyway.
It's 2016. Who the hell has pubes anymore?
Married men.
Wow, this is going off the fucking rails. Oh my god.
Anyway.
Talk about that.
Anyway, gentlemen, yeah. Pete, it was really great having you on again. You really brought mediocre news to the show. Thank you very much.
Oh man, saved it.
Yeah, right. Guys, happy holidays.
You got from that.
Yo,
I'm
going to stop talking at once. Jesus.
I'm going to say Merry Christmas to everybody here. It's I hope everyone has a good holiday.
Hanukkah.
I hope Hanukkah. Well, I don't think anyone's Jewish, right? Any fans out there that are Jewish, happy Hanukkah. Merry Christmas.
Happy Kwanzaa, Omar.
We're going to be here before New Year's. We're going to be here before New Year's. Happy Festivus, if anybody knows what that means.
I got my kente cloth. I got my tablecloth on. It's over. I'm ready to go.
On three, everyone talk. But I guess we'll be back. We'll get a chance to discuss the upcoming cards for UFC and the World Series of Fighting in New York if we want to briefly touch on it. But, you know, I really had fun with this discussion, guys, and I appreciate it. Anybody out there, remember to subscribe to our YouTube channel. It's still spinning back this. We got to change that. But, like I said, Omar's vigorously working on getting these episodes on there. So
Omar, you
have another platform to listen to our banter back and forth, our train going off the tracks quickly. But, you know, I just want to take this time to wish everybody a Merry Christmas. And no, I'm just kidding.
Again.
Yeah, you're right. if you remember the Thanksgiving episode, you'll remember what I'm talking about. But, no, this was
absolutely
fun.
That's why I'm laughing. I remember.
Right. I'm looking forward to the banter going forward, guys. And I know, I guess.
Everybody,
yeah, everybody
drive
safe
everybody
out there. Watch out for the cops. Please. Don't drive dirty.
Oh,
and,
watch out for John.
Anybody listening out there, anybody listening out there, X out of their screen 15 minutes ago.
No, I disagree,
yeah, well,
but right. As soon as the Jungle Pete says his name, ba-boom. But I'll talk to you guys next week. It's been fun, as usual.
Hardcore.
All
right, guys.
You motherfuckers ain't hardcore. Yeah, so.
So do you guys, honestly, do you really, I really am surprised that, you know, they do this thing, if you look on the internet, the top 10 stories of 2016, number 10 is actually the Nate Diaz and the rise of him and how after 25 fights, it's pretty remarkable that he took this long in his career to actually get the, I don't want to say the recognition for what he's done,
but I'm
happy for him. You're right, it is recognition. I don't want to say, but it really is.
It's not. You know, like, he was deserving of this for a long time, and it took Conor to catapult him to that level. So, you know, I'm as a Diaz fan, I'm grateful for it because he's finally getting the platform that he should have been on his whole career.
It took him beating Conor.
Of course,
Conor.
I acknowledge that.
He's like, no, Omar, he is low-blowing it. I get the whole McGregor thing, but he's right. Like, Diaz did tap McGregor out, so that helped him. If he would have lost to McGregor.
No, but what I'm saying is if he didn't beat McGregor, he wouldn't really
happened,
be
right.
in any kind of
no,
conversation.
No, shit, but
you know what I mean?
You're 100% right.
That opportunity. Carpe diem, man. He fucking had the chance to do, you know, Irish ninja, fucking American ninja, let's fucking do this shit.
Irish
ninja. It was a good time.
Really?
It was a good time.
Really?
He is, though.
Irish ninja.
I want to see more wannabes.
Bro, did you not fucking hear Nate call out after the Michael Johnson fight?
Yeah, I know what you're talking about.
He was
about.
Like, Irish ninja, American ninja, let's do this shit. That's what Nate said.
The
he
fucking
the master ninja.
The Mexican cable guy. That's what Nate reminds me
oh
of.
Oh, my God.
The cable guy.
What, turn
God,
Tony Ferguson?
You're the
with
guinea
the
ninja over there.
That's right.
All right, well,
he's okay.
I'm signing off.
Yo, the
I'm
Guinea Ninja
off,
has
dude.
Marinara. The Guinea Ninja has marinara sauce on his belly.
I just wanna. I wanna clarify this. So on the show, Chris is like no race, but the minute the show's done, though,
It's not that I don't. I'm not like nervous to talk about race, but I just don't think that we should spend 15 minutes, 10 minutes talking about something like that. We really don't really.
We live in
a
divided America.
I don't think the whole thing was about race. I think it was about Woodley trying to be hood and taking it like Ferguson.
It was about selling
race
tickets.
That was something that I think is near and dear to Chris's heart.
The Woodley thing, as a person who was listening and wasn't on the line, was tough to listen to.
Yeah, I just think that something like that has nothing to do with fighting, and we were talking about it for too long.
Yeah.
Well, you know, we're an MMA podcast, not like a Ferguson race. You know, this isn't that's not our platform.
Yeah, but all right, well, so look at it this way. All right.
Bullshit.
Why Carl brought it up? Yeah, but wait, why Carl brought it up? Let's say.
I think Tommy's taking a dump right now. I just need to call him out a little bit on this. What the
Tommy's
fuck are you up
to? Go drive to? No, Tommy's getting ready to go drive to 7-Eleven to go get more nuts.
More blunts?
You got to tap on your window twice? Do you flash your lights? I can't,
no. No, look at it this way. Let's say Gegard Mousasi was going to fight somebody, and he was going to be like, yo, they were bringing the 9-11 out in me. It's the same thing as what...
Woodley
is from Ferguson, Missouri, dude.
I don't care. Nobody heard about Ferguson until it was riot. That's what it's about. It's not about where he's from. It's about what happened because that guy got shot.
Their diner game is nuts. Guy Fieri told me. Their diner game is nuts. Stop it.
Oh, that's fact checker. We didn't have to bring the fact checker out once. Why are you starting now? Damn it. No, I'm kidding.
They had a really good CVS until that night, too, I heard.
Carl's really passionate about this.
Oh, no.
I am. It pisses me off. The people died. Don't use that. Don't compare that to your sport where you're making millions of dollars to people dying. I don't like that. It pisses me off.
It's still a sport.
It really
exactly.
Does.
It's not life and death.
Right.
Yeah,
it's not
right.
Real life.
You're absolutely right.
Comparing it to people dying. Like, if he didn't grow up there, I don't think he would have said Ferguson.
Well,
right.
Too bad. He referenced the riots and people dying because of it.
No, he didn't.
And whatever.
No.
Dude,
he referenced
that's
where
what
he
meant
up.
By Ferguson. No, it's not.
How
bullshit.
Do you know what he meant, dude? How could
because.
You sit here and say what he meant?
Because I know what he meant. I know
secretly.
What he's thinking.
All right, I'm
back. On the inside.
Good show, guys. I'll talk to you next week.
Okay. Yeah.
Take it easy, man.
I think I'll
take care,
the
guys.
Boards.
I think that you feel that he meant that because you didn't know that he was from Ferguson the first time you heard him say it.
No,
well,
I did.
He's
I
not
just,
hardcore.
I know him
because he's not hardcore
right.
Enough, right?
I didn't look. I don't spend hours on YouTube trying to learn MMA. That's why.
Yeah,
right.
But no, you don't, yeah, but just like Carl was saying, you never heard anything about Ferguson. Like you didn't know it was this tough neighborhood until all this shit happened. So I get it.
Exactly. Exactly. You know, hey, there's something to it. I just don't
like
that.
Yeah, but Woodley did because he grew up there.
Yeah.
All right. Well,
okay.
Goodbye. Goodbye.
See you guys. Seth Pritchard.
Take it easy, guys. Take care. I love you. You
later,
guys.
Are
savages.
Jesse Jack.
Take care. Take care.